glad that you are here with us this morning. Won't you stand as we begin to sing together? And ladies, if you wouldn't mind to sing with me. And fellas, if you would please sing along with Dylan.
Two services downstairs, and we just want to thank you so much for being here today. If you are a first-time guest, hopefully You got one of these cards handed to you as you were walking in the door. On the front of that, there is a place for you to fill out some information for us. Just tear that small portion off, and at the end of the service, take it down the back stairwell straight into a booth that has this logo on a banner behind it. And we just want to give you a free gift for being here today with us. Now, on the back side of that, there is also a place for you to take notes, and for the bottom portion that you can rip off, that is for our regular guests who attend. We want to thank you for being here today as well. If you have any kind of information change, that is where you would do that for us to be able to stay in contact with you. Also, there is a place for you to RSVP to our Wednesday night meal. It's a great meal. It's only $5. You can't beat it. And we have that down in the CLC at 5:15 on Wednesday nights. So we are going to continue to praise the Lord, and He is such a good, good Father.
I've heard a thousand stories of what they think you're like, but I've heard the tender whisper of love in the dead of night, and you tell me that your beliefs and that I never you.
Let's continue to worship as Rebecca leads us.
You are welcome here.
small groups are a great way for you to find connections here at FCC. It is important to find people who are like-minded. We have lots of different offerings of small groups, and some of those are starting in October. So if you'll go down, also in the atrium at the bottom of the steps is the connections desk. Find out a little bit more about small groups and find one that is a good fit for you. Another exciting thing going on in October is the fall retreat for our youth program. This retreat is for middle schoolers and high schoolers. I have a couple of each, and it is a great way for them to make good friends. I've been doing this for a few years. It is a sweet, sweet weekend for them to grow spiritually, and it's also a time for them to be sleep-deprived and a little crazy. And that's the best time to make really, really good friends, because we believe that connections for our young people are just as important. Let's pray together over our offering. Dear Lord, thank you so much that we can come into your presence. We come to you with humility, and we come with open hearts to receive your blessings. But we also come with open hands. We bring you our sacrifices. We bring you these offerings, and we pray that they will further glorify your kingdom. It's in your Son's name that we give, and in your Son's name that we pray. Amen.
The kids are playing, are laughing, joyful.
It's like a whole world to them, because for the first time they have received this precious gift.
The message through the box is not only the toys that makes them smile. The message here is that Jesus loves them.
You've got an army of volunteers that pack the boxes. They're helping OCC to take the gospel literally to millions of children.
Operation Christmas Child has been a part of my life for many years. I can remember going out with my mom and dad and collecting the perfect items for our shoebox that we were going to make that year. However, the impact of the shoebox didn't truly hit me until last year when I attended the Operation Christmas Child Packing Center trip with Kathy and the team here at First Christian Church. We went onto the warehouse floor, and everybody truly does have a job to do that day. It's very well managed and organized, and so everybody feels like they have a part in this ministry. On the warehouse floor, there is a board with the names of the countries of where the boxes have been and are going that have been processed at Boone. This made the ministry very real to me to see exactly where the boxes were going that we had worked on that particular day. If you have not been to the Operation Christmas Child Processing Center, I challenge you to make this year the year that you will go. To sign up, go to www.fcc-jc.org or sign up in the atrium today.
We are opening doors for other churches and other parts of the world to do ministry in their local community.
They receive a box and also an invitation to come back and learn more about Christ.
We just don't want to just hand out a box and stop there. We want them to grow in their faith.
Operation Christmas Child begins today. Stop by the atrium and pick up your box and fill it up and turn it in no later than Sunday, November 13th. Our goal this year is 1,000 boxes. I know we can do it, FCC.
So it started with a box, and it's ending with communities and countries being changed. With the sound so full, it cracks the sky. Whoa.
Never ceases to amaze me how a simple box can change the world for a child.
Thousands will be impacted by just one gift.
Hallelujah, amen.
There's a line in an old hymn that goes something like this. My hope is built on nothing less than Jesus' blood and righteousness. We come to communion time to remember and to be reminded that one thing remains, and that one thing is Jesus, the Messiah. Leaders of nations come and go. Some are good, some are not so good. Nations rise and falter. Civilizations grow and decline. And while those things do affect us greatly, they are not where our hope rests. We rest in the hope of the one who created all things, including the nations, and the one who holds the whole universe together by his power. Our hope is in the one who died and rose again and will raise us again with him. Our hope is exclusively in Jesus Christ, the crucified and risen one, the one who said, "I am the way and the truth and the life, and no one comes to the Father but through me." Jesus, he is the one thing. Jesus, he is everything. Jesus is the way. Jesus is the truth. Jesus is the life. Jesus is the light of the world. Everything else will fail and will pass away, yet one thing remains: Jesus. It's all about him. My hope is built on nothing less than Jesus' blood and his righteousness. Let's remember this as we come to our communion time today, to remember and be reminded of the one thing, Jesus.
Let us pray. Dear Heavenly Father, we thank you for this glorious day and for this opportunity to worship you. We come now remembering the sacrifice of your Son, Jesus, and we celebrate the new and abundant life that we have in calling him Lord and Savior. And we just pray that our lives would point others to you. I ask all these things in Jesus' name. Amen.
Well, hey, church, it is super good to be with you. My name is Ethan Magnus. I'm one of the pastors here. If you're a guest with us today, we are so glad that you're here today. We think you're in the right place. I hope already you've been made to feel welcome. I hope the worship of God has been a blessing to you, as it always is to me. But I, in part, think you're in the right place because I think that God has this thing God always wants to do. When we find ourselves kind of stuck in the trivial and the unimportant, when we and our find ourselves distracted by what doesn't really matter, God wants to shake us out of that. We're talking in this series, Majoring in the Minors, about the minor prophets. They're not minor because they're insignificant. They're just minor because they're short. We're talking about the minor prophets, and the way the minor prophets functioned in the life of Israel was to interrupt their everyday lives, to interrupt their everyday moment, and to call them to what most truly mattered. And so we're just trusting that God is going to do the same thing with us, to interrupt our lives a little bit and call us back to what's most important. We looked last week at the book of Amos. If you weren't here for that, jump online, pick up a CD. It was a great conversation of getting called back to be people of justice and righteousness. This week we're going to look at Zechariah, next week Hosea, and the week after that, talking about Jonah. Now, this week, Zechariah is probably the least well-known of the four prophets we're going to be talking about. Some of you may have never read the book of Zechariah. That's all right. Don't worry about it. I had never read the book of Zechariah until I read it for the first time either. So if that's your situation, that's fine, okay? So, but here's the thing about the book of Zechariah. It is fantastic. What I love about the book of Zechariah is he kind of sits at this pivot point. He looks back at all the prophets that have gone before him. He himself has a very productive ministry during a very pivotal time in the history of God's people. But then also, much of his preaching, many of his oracles look forward to the work of God that is yet to come. And in fact, today, we're just going to look at two oracles. We're going to look at one that looks back and one that looks forward. And we're just going to ignore all the oracles in the middle that were really focused on his time. You can go back and read them. They're all great, too. Just we only have time to talk about so much. Zechariah's ministry happened during the rebuilding years after the exile. If you don't know the story, don't worry, I'll catch you up real quick. Basically, in the 800s, 800 years BC, before Jesus, God's people were living in these two nations. They were not living faithfully to God, and so God allowed them to be conquered, and many of the people were taken into exile in Babylon. After about 70 years of exile, they began to come back and began to rebuild their homes, their families, their farms, their temple, their government, their cities. This rebuilding period was when Zechariah's ministry took place. It was a period in some sense of great hope, but also of great suffering and great struggle. The rebuilding was going slow. Their lives were very unstable and very dangerous. And that's the world in which Zechariah serves. All right, like I said, we're going to look at two oracles. One that looks back, his very first oracle from Zechariah chapter 1, and one that looks forward, an oracle from Zechariah chapter 9. Our method here is simple. We're just going to tear into God's word and trust that God's got good stuff for us in it, and I think we'll find that God will be faithful to that. If you've got a Bible, feel free to look along Zechariah chapter 1. If you've got it on your phone or your iPad, feel free to use that. It'll also be up on the screens. In the eighth month of the second year of Darius, the word of the Lord came to the prophet Zechariah, son of Berechiah, son of Iddo. The Lord was very angry with your ancestors. Therefore, tell the people, this is what the Lord Almighty says. Return to me, declares the Lord Almighty, and I will return to you, says the Lord Almighty. I'm going to pause there for a second. I'll get back to the text in a minute. Did any of you growing up feel like your parents had an angry voice? They may have that, like, you know my parents did. My mom, when she was really angry, her voice went up an octave. My dad, when he was really angry, his voice went down an octave. You know, as a parent, I can tell you kids who are here, this is something parents train in. We go to classes when our kids are young, you know. I had to perfect, because angry voices are hard, right? You've got to be angry enough that your kid actually stops what they're doing and pay attention, but not so angry that they burst into tears on the floor. You know what I'm saying? That's a fine line to strike, you know, to hit that right, perfect level of angry. I mention this because I think a lot of people wonder what God's angry voice sounds like. I think a lot of us are pretty sure that if God had something to say to us, what he would say would be angry. And we're really worried what his angry voice sounds like. And so maybe we resist talking to God. We resist a relationship with God because we're worried about what God's angry voice sounds like. Well, if that's you, pay attention right here to this text, because here, we're going to find out what God's angry voice sounds like. Back to verse 2 there. The Lord was very angry with your ancestors. Therefore, tell the people, this is what the Lord Almighty says. Return to me, declares the Lord Almighty, and I will return to you. Do not be like your ancestors, to whom the earlier prophets proclaimed, this is what the Lord Almighty says, turn from your evil ways and your evil practices. But they would not listen or pay attention to me, declares the Lord. Well, where are they now? And the prophets, they didn't live forever. But didn't my words and my decrees, which I commanded my servants, the prophets, to say, didn't they overtake your ancestors? Then, only after the punishment came, they repented and said, the Lord Almighty has done to us what our ways and practices deserve, just as he determined to do. There's so much we got to notice here. So this is Zechariah looking back at 400 years of prophetic history and trying to just summarize the message of the prophets. And there's a lot to notice. One of the things just to notice up front is to notice that Zechariah's summary of the prophets doesn't include any mention of them predicting things. We often get that confused. We use the word prophet to mean someone who predicts stuff. But that isn't the way the Bible uses the word prophet. While some prophets did predict things, the thing that made them prophets wasn't their predictions. It was that they spoke on behalf of God. In fact, if you go read the prophets, the vast majority of their stuff isn't predicting stuff at all. It's they show up and say, hey, that over there, stop doing that. God says it's a sin. That over there, do more of that. God wants that. That over there, don't you remember what the Bible says about that? That's what the prophets did. They showed up and spoke on behalf of God. So that's the first thing Zechariah does, is he reminds us what the prophets did. They called the people away from their evil ways toward God's ways. The second thing he does, and this is just huge, this is just a gift. If you, like me, sometimes worry about what does God's angry voice sound like. If you know I have angered God, and listen, I don't know how you wake up every day and not someday realize I angered God yesterday. And so if you, like me, wonder what God sounds like when he's angry, you got to pay attention to Zechariah, because this is what God sounds like when he's angry. Return to me, declares the Lord, and I will return to you. God's angry voice sounds like mercy. That's amazing. We're going to talk later in the message that there are people in the world who don't know that, who need to know that. God's angry voice sounds like mercy. So that's where Zechariah starts. He starts by reminding us. He says, don't be like everybody else who didn't listen to the merciful anger of God and instead had to face God's discipline. Don't be like all those people. He looks backwards. Now we're going to jump all the way to Zechariah 9. We're going to jump to a text that looks forward. They're looking forward. Now, it's interesting to notice, Zechariah 1 through 8 is all about the limited good that we can do through our faithful effort. Listen, Zechariah is not a person who's given up on humanity. He thinks we can do good through our faithful effort. But at some point, he recognizes what we can do through our effort pales in comparison with what is needed to be done. And in Zechariah 9, he calls us to look beyond what we can do to what God can do. Listen to this great oracle, starting in Zechariah 9, verse 9, all the way through verse 17. Rejoice greatly, O daughter Zion. Shout aloud, daughter Jerusalem. Look, your king comes to you, righteous and victorious, lowly and riding on a donkey, on a colt, the foal of a donkey. I will take away the chariots from Ephraim, the war horses from Jerusalem, and the battle bow will be broken.
He will proclaim peace to all the nations. His rule will extend from sea to sea, from the river to the ends of the earth. And as for you, because of the blood of my covenant with you, I will free your prisoners from a dry hole. I will return to your fortress the prisoners of hope. Even now I declare I will restore twice as much to you as that which was taken. I will bend Judah as I bend my bow. I will fill it up with Ephraim. I will rouse your son Zion against your sons Greece and make you like a warrior's sword. Then the Lord will appear over them all. His arrow will flash like lightning. The sovereign Lord will sound the trumpet. He will march in the storms of the south, and the Lord Almighty will shield them. Then they will destroy and overcome with sling stones. They will drink and roar as with wine. They will be full like a bowl used for sprinkling the corners of the altar. The Lord their God will save his people on that day, as a shepherd saves his flock. They will sparkle in his land like jewels in a crown. How attractive and beautiful they will be. Grain will make the young men thrive, and new wine the young women. I love that oracle. What a great word of hope. A word where Zechariah pushes us beyond what is possible by our own strength and looks to that which could be if God were to intervene and God were to act. And so much of that oracle, you don't even need to think too hard. It just kind of washes over you, and the truth of God's good promises is there. You hear the promise that God will send a king. God will send a king of peace, not a king of war. You hear the promise that weapons of war will be forgotten, the chariot abandoned, the battle bow broken. There is the promise in this oracle that our enemies will be defeated. But it's fascinating. If you look at the full scope of the oracle, you see that the nature of the defeat is perhaps different than what we would expect. I would expect that if I had an enemy and my enemy was defeated, that would be good for me and bad for my enemy, right? Wouldn't you expect that? But that isn't what this text describes at all. It describes that God's peace will extend to all nations. So the enemies of God are defeated, and yet even that is for their blessing, not for their cursing. It says that prisoners will be rescued. And there at the end, I love this. Y'all will love this too. Did you catch at the very end, the promise at the very end, right? All of our children will be beautiful. Did you notice that? Verse 17, yeah, catch this. It's important. This is the promise of God. How attractive and beautiful they will be. Grain will make the young men thrive, and new wine, the young women. He says, it'll be great. Even our kids will be pretty when God finally does what God. And I know some of you are saying your kids are already pretty. I know. That's the mercies of God already present with us, even as we wait for God to finish his good work. Okay. There are a couple parts there, though. In the midst of this oracle, so much of it just kind of washes over us like this great hope of peace and rescue. There are a couple of parts that may be just a little bit confusing to us. There's that line there in verse 11 where God's been talking about how all the nations will be blessed and all the nations will receive peace. And then he turns to talk to God's people and he says, as for you, my people, because of the blood of my covenant with you. And then he goes on to make those promises about rescuing them from the dry hole, rescuing them from the prisoner, who are prisoners of hope, rescuing those from whom much has been taken. Because of the blood of my covenant to you. Now, if you've spent much time in the church, your first instinct might be to hear those words as we sometimes use those words about Jesus Christ. We talk about the blood of Christ's covenant with us, that by his blood we are healed and redeemed and made whole and can stand before God. And of course, in some ways, those words do prefigure the work of Christ. But they couldn't have been about that the first time they got said, because remember, Zechariah is 500 years before Christ. And if they were about Jesus, they wouldn't have meant anything to the people he was talking to. What's interesting is what they meant to those people was very, very clear. They had a practice we don't know much about, a practice of promise making, of covenant making. You see this covenant making practice in Genesis 12, 15, and 17. When God makes a series of promises to Abraham, In these promises-keeping ceremonies, they do this odd little thing. After the promises have been made, they cut animals in half and they smear a little line of blood with them. And then they step through the animals across the line of blood. It's kind of a gross symbol, a symbol of their commitment to the promises extends beyond life and death itself. God is saying in this odd little image, an image seems odd to us, it would have been clear to them, he would have said, as for you, my people, as for you, my people, I keep my promises. I love that. Because of the blood of the covenant I have with you, I keep my promises. The promises he made in that odd little ceremony were promises to bless Abraham and his descendants, who would be God's people, and to through them bless all people. And there it is. Coming true here in the prophecy of Zechariah. He says, this will be the day when God finally makes good on the promises he made, that God's people will be blessed, and through them he will bless all people. One other little place in this text that probably deserves some explanation. Without it, we probably would just gloss over it and miss it. We just kind of ignore it and skip on. Right there in between the thing where it says, rejoice, O daughter Jerusalem, and the part where it says he'll take away the chariots and break the battle bow, there's this little odd thing about donkeys. Did you catch that? Let's read that again. Zechariah 9:9. Rejoice greatly, daughter Zion. Shout, daughter Jerusalem. Look, your king comes to you, righteous and victorious. Now, if you stop for a second and picture what a king should look like, when they arrive, righteous and victorious, marching on into the city, don't you sort of picture them standing up in a chariot as the army marches in behind them? Or perhaps riding on a great war horse, surrounded by their cavalry and their castle guard in glistening armor? Or maybe they're sitting up on one of those special thrones that they hold up on sticks, you know, held by the 12 strongest warriors so that everyone can see the great and victorious king. That's how I picture a great and victorious king. But that isn't what Zechariah says. See, your king comes to you, righteous and victorious, lowly, and riding on a donkey, on a colt, a baby donkey. What an interesting image. It seems almost foreign to us. It would have been very well known to Zechariah's listeners. He's appealing here to a very common Middle Eastern practice in the ancient world. When a king arrived into a city with peaceful intentions, they entered on a donkey. When they arrived for war, they entered on a chariot or a horse. We see this happening. It could be your own king. If the king came into town on a donkey, you know, oh good, phew, they're just here for a visit. But if they came into town on a horse, everyone knew they're here for soldiers. We're off to war. Battle is at hand. It could be a conquering king. When you lose the war and the king rides into the city that he has just captured, he could ride in on a horse. And everyone would know we are doomed. He is here to take all that he can, to pillage all that we own, to leave most of us dead and the city destroyed. Or he could ride in on a donkey, and the people would know we are saved. Though he has defeated our army, he plans to treat us with peace. We'll pay taxes, sure. We'll have some tribute we have to give, but he's not going to kill us all, at least. The city is saved. For Zechariah, this image of a victorious king riding in on a donkey would have been so commonplace, I'm not even sure it would have felt like the center of the oracle. I think they would have focused in their day on the promise to keep his promises, on the promise that he would fight their battles for them. They would no longer have to fight for themselves. I don't think they would have focused too much on the donkey part. And if that's the case, you might be wondering, well, then why did I? If they wouldn't have focused too much on the donkey part, why would I have focused so much on the donkey part? Well, the reason is this. That part about the donkey, That became one of the central realities to one of the most important moments in the life of Jesus Christ. I don't know if you know this. There are only about 10 stories that are told by all four of the Gospels. You know, the four Gospels all tell mostly different stories about Jesus. And there are only just a few that all four of them tell. And most of them are stuff like the crucifixion, the Last Supper, the feeding of the 5,000. I mean, they're huge stuff, right? But there's this one story about the time Jesus rode on a donkey. And they all tell that. We'll read it from the Gospel of Luke, but we could use any of them. They're all pretty similar. The Gospel of Luke tells the story this way. After Jesus had said this, he had just been giving some parables that we don't have time to read. He went on ahead, going up toward Jerusalem. As he approached Bethphage and Bethany at the hill called the Mount of Olives, he sent two of his disciples, saying to them, "Go to the village ahead of you. As you enter it, you will find a colt tied there, which no one has ever ridden. Untie it and bring it here. If anyone asks you, 'Why are you untying it?' say, 'The Lord needs it.' Those who were sent ahead went and found it just as he had told them. As they were untying the colt, its owners asked them, 'Why are you untying the colt?' And they replied, 'The Lord needs it.' They brought it to Jesus. They threw their cloaks on the colt and put Jesus on it. As he went along, people spread their cloaks on the road. When he came near the place, pay attention to this moment, when he came near to the place where the road turns to go down the Mount of Olives, aiming straight for the city of Jerusalem, the whole crowd of disciples began to joyfully praise God, shouting in loud voices for all the miracles they had seen. 'Blessed is the King who comes in the name of the Lord. Peace in heaven, glory in the highest.' Some of the Pharisees in the crowd said to Jesus, 'Teacher, stop your disciples.' 'I tell you,' he replied, 'if they were to keep quiet, the stones themselves would cry out.'" I don't know. I don't know if you've thought much about just what an amazing thing is happening on that day Jesus decided he needed a donkey to ride into Jerusalem. Maybe you've never thought much about it at all, you know. Maybe you just figured he was tired or something, or, you know, wanted to give his feet a break. But I don't think that was it. This was the same guy who had walked up and down the dusty streets of Judea and Galilee for 3 straight years. He'd been to Jerusalem dozens of times. He'd never asked for a donkey before. The reason all four Gospels tell this story, the reason the crowds went wild, the reason the Pharisees tell them to stop, and the reason Jesus says they won't, is because in this moment, Jesus is claiming, with a clarity that has never been matched before in his ministry, he is the Messiah. He is the one. He is the King of Peace that Zechariah promised. You see, we need to think for a little bit about what it means to say Jesus fulfilled a prophecy. We don't mean he stumbled into it, you know. This isn't like some fantasy novel where halfway through the novel you discover, oops, the main character accidentally fulfilled some ancient prophecy. God wrote these prophecies. God gave these prophecies. God authored the history in which they were uttered and the history in which they were fulfilled. When Jesus fulfills a prophecy, he does it on purpose. You see, Jesus, knowing his time was short, thinks to himself, yeah, we're going to need a donkey for this one. Yeah, can go to the next town. Yeah, let's do the donkey thing. I think that'll be clear enough. Yeah, we do that, everybody will know. You see, he didn't luck into this. He enacted it. He said, "Get me a donkey. We're going to ride into Jerusalem. Because by the time I get to Jerusalem, I want everybody to know who I think I am."
And I love the way Luke tells the story. It's like everybody's just chilling. They get a donkey, he's riding around the mountain, and then boom, they come to the place where they turn the corner and the road aims downhill straight toward the road up into Jerusalem, and everybody goes insane. They're like, oh my goodness, this is it. This is Zechariah 9. It's happening right here, but we're living to see Zechariah's words come true. He's on a donkey. He's riding into Jerusalem. I know. I saw the donkey. I'm the one who got the donkey. I didn't know what it was for. He just said, get a donkey. How could I have possibly known he was going to ride into Jerusalem? Who could have thought? And as soon as the crowd goes wild, and what do they say? They know exactly what to say. Blessed is the King who comes in the name of the Lord. Peace from heaven. And glory in the highest. They know what is happening. Jesus knew the prophecy. His disciples knew the prophecy. The crowds knew the prophecy. The Pharisees knew the prophecy. So when he grabs a donkey to ride into town, it was not on accident. It was on purpose, because he had something to say. He was claiming, I am the King of Peace. I am the one here not to build an army, but to scatter the weapons. I am the one here to defeat our enemies, not by destroying them, but by including them in my great kingdom of peace. I am the one to declare release to the captives. I am the one to restore what was taken twofold. I am the one who, yes, who will make your children beautiful. That's me. I am the King of Peace, and I have arrived to do God's work. And everyone there knew exactly what he was saying. This was not subtle, folks. This was not confusing. He was riding on a donkey into Jerusalem as the people shouted Hosanna, and everyone there had to choose. They either had to choose to serve him, or they chose to kill him. At this point, there just weren't many choices left. You know, I suppose 6 months prior, you could have said, yeah, I think he's an interesting teacher. I'm going to kind of be influenced by his philosophy, but I'll be influenced by this philosophy and that philosophy too. I kind of take my rabbis in doses. That option was gone when he got on a donkey and rode up the road to Jerusalem. Because now he's announced, I'm the King. I was reading a guy reflecting on this text. He said, you know, there is something inside each one of us that does not want a king. And there is something inside each one of us that wants to be the king. And then here comes Jesus, just riding in on a donkey. No war horse, no chariot, no battle bow. So we get to pick. He's just there on a donkey. He says, I'm here. I'm the King. And some will bow down, and some will rebel. Zechariah says the prophets kept showing up, calling people to turn, calling people to return. And then Jesus rode in to my life on a donkey. He rides into your life on a donkey. It's not particularly dramatic, but now you've read Zechariah 9, so now you know what it means. You know, before you could have pretended you didn't know what it meant when Jesus showed up riding on a donkey, but now you do. When Jesus rides into your life on a donkey, he's telling you he thinks he's king. And he's asking you who you think he is. He's telling you he's the King of Peace for all nations, and he's asking you who you think he is. He's telling you he's the King who rescues those trapped in bondage. He's asking you who you think he is. He's telling you who's the King who provides refuge for the prisoner and restores what was broken. And he's asking you who you think he is. Like the people on that day, we need to face up to the radical claim Jesus is making. He's saying, I'm the one Zechariah talked about. I'm the King, righteous and victorious.
against whom no enemy will stand, but my intention is that my enemies become my people, that they be restored, and that my empire, my reign of peace, would extend everywhere. He wants his reign of peace even to extend to your life. When you meet a king, you've got a couple choices. The first choice is whether you will live as a subject or a rebel. That's kind of it, right? The king says he's in charge. You will either live as a subject, you will live under the reign of the king, or will you live in rebellion to the reign of the king? If you're wrestling with that choice, Zechariah says you need to pay attention to what God sounds like when he's angry. Because remember, when God's angry, he sounds like mercy. He says, "Return to me, and I will return to you." There is something in us that does not want a king, but we need a king. And Jesus says, "I'm here, the King of Peace." If you've made the decision, though, to live as Jesus' subject, there is a second decision you must make. For God does not want you to merely live as his subject. He wants you to live as his herald. That's what the crowd did, right? As soon as Jesus turned the corner, as soon as they realized just what he was doing with that donkey, their voices broke out. They remembered every miracle they'd ever seen. They bore witness to every miracle they'd ever heard of. And then they just shouted aloud, "Blessed is the King who comes in the name of the Lord. Peace in heaven and glory to God in the highest." Church, I just want you to know, Jesus Christ has showed up in your life on a donkey. The first invitation is to live as his subject. Let him be king. And the second invitation is to live as his herald. Tell the world, oh, please, tell somebody that God's angry voice sounds like mercy. Tell them that God's king is a king of peace. Tell them that God's king came to restore what was lost and release the prisoner. Tell them God came to make our children beautiful. Just be a herald for the great King Jesus Christ. Let me pray for you. Oh God, please do not let your word return void, but let it have its effect in us. Let it do its work in us. Oh God, let us recognize the reality that you have shown up on a donkey. Your claim is clear. Our ignorance is no longer a problem. We know who you think you are. And now we need to decide who we think you are. God, bend our knee to you as king. And then open our lips that we would be the herald of your reign of peace. In Jesus' name we pray. Amen. Church, I invite you to stand. We're going to sing together a song of our commitment that God is our king and we will live as his herald. If that's a commitment you've never made before, I would invite you to come forward and make that commitment for the first time today and be baptized into Christ's kingdom. And for all of you, I would challenge you to live as heralds of the King of Peace. Let's sing together.
Every knee will bow.
God, you have heard our song. Make it be our pledge of loyalty to you. And as we go from this place, God, give us the words to live as your heralds, that you are a God of mercy and your King is a King of peace. In Jesus' name we pray. Amen. Church, have a great week. Tell somebody that Jesus is a King of peace.